Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we explore the frontiers of theoretical physics. Today I'm here with Olaf Hohm.
Hello.
And Allison Pinto.
Hi.
Olaf is a research group leader here at Humboldt University in Berlin, working on string theory, one of the candidate models to describe physics beyond the standard model. And Allison is a PhD student working in Olaf's group. Thank you for being here with us.
Glad to be here.
Today, Olaf and Allison are here to talk about how we can modify the theory of gravity. Gravity is one of the four fundamental forces of nature, and we experience it all the time in our lives. It is what keeps us on the ground and not floating away in space. It is also the force that attracts all objects with mass to each other, no matter how far apart they are. In the late 1600s, Isaac Newton introduced a gravitational force to describe the motion of celestial bodies. Later, in the early 1900s, Albert Einstein developed the theory of general relativity, in which gravity is seen as a consequence of matter curving space and time. Since then, general relativity passed many tests, so it seems quite robust. Then, why should one consider modifying this theory?
Well, we have the standard model of particle physics with the electromagnetic force, the weak force and the strong force, and they're all mediated by particles. The electromagnetic force by the photon, the weak force by the W and Z bosons, and the strong force by gluons. And we know that if gravity becomes part of a quantum theory, there must be a graviton that mediates that force. And one way to study possible theories of a graviton is to see how it behaves under modifications.
I'm curious, could you tell us more about one of these modifications?
Sure. So one thing we could try to do is to assume that the graviton has a mass. So from our current understanding, general relativity leads to a massless graviton. But what if that were not the case?
So could the graviton have a mass, and what could we learn from this? Let's find out. We could start by talking about the theory of general relativity. Perhaps you could tell us more about how it works.
Sure. So in general relativity, gravity is a consequence of the geometry of the universe that we live in. So imagine a sheet of fabric. If you place an object on this fabric, then the fabric would bend around that object. And if you were to place something else nearby, it would move along the curve of the fabric towards that object. And this fabric is what we call space-time. And the motion of objects, which we describe by the gravitational force, is actually due to the geometry of the space-time.
Right, but how do we know that general relativity describes gravity the right way?
Well, there is a lot of evidence. So for instance, we've observed gravitational waves and black holes, which were both predictions of the theory. And on top of that, we have our GPS navigation system, which even depends on the precision of the theory.
So our observation seems to fit quite well with the prediction. However, when we try to study quantum gravity, we don't have any help from the experimental side, right?
You're quite right. And the problem is that the gravity is the weakest force. So we have not been able to measure the graviton directly in experiments, and we won't be able to do that for the foreseeable future. So for now, we're confined to study the theory theoretically. So by looking at possible modifications of the theory, we can learn about quantum gravity.
That's why we talk then about the mass of the graviton. So, but how do we measure the mass of a particle if we cannot see it?
Good question. So in Einstein's theory of special relativity, we know that a particle or wave moves at the speed of light if it's massless. And that's the case for electromagnetic waves or photons. And according to general relativity, it's also the case for gravitational waves, which are ripples in space-time and should move at the speed of light. So these have actually been measured in 2015 by LIGO, and the data are compatible with general relativity, which suggests that the graviton should be like the photon, a massless particle.
But doesn't this rule out the existence of massive gravitons?
Well, due to experimental uncertainty, we can't be really sure that the graviton has zero mass. So it might have a really tiny mass, and that would mean that gravitational waves would travel slightly slower than the speed of light.
So even though we cannot observe the graviton directly, we can still infer its mass from the speed of the gravitational wave. Now, if the principle behind general relativity lead to a massless graviton, This means that to obtain a massive graviton, we would need a totally different theory with different principle. Can you say maybe something more about this?
Yeah, so in general relativity, the masslessness of gravitational waves is directly related to something called a gauge symmetry. So that refers to a redundancy of the description of the theory. Allison, didn't you have a nice example about that?
Yeah, I do. So my favorite example has to do with merry-go-rounds. So imagine you're standing in front of a merry-go-round and you want to know what is the time it takes for it to make one rotation. So how would you do that? You would pick a horse, get your stopwatch, and then see when the horse comes back to its starting position, then you read the time. And the time that you measure doesn't depend on which horse you picked. You could have picked any other horse. So the choice of horse is what we call in physics a gauge. And the merry-go-round has a gauge symmetry, meaning that any quantity that has physical meaning doesn't depend on the choice of the gauge.
That's a nice example, Allison. So in general relativity is sort of similar. If you imagine an observer who wants to make measurements, he will produce a map of the universe and he will use this map to record the positions of certain objects, let's say. And any meaningful measurement should be independent of what kind of map he chooses. So this choice of a map is like your choice of a horse. And in general relativity, the choice of map should not matter, and that is the gauge symmetry of general relativity.
What does gauge symmetry have to do with the graviton?
So it implies that the graviton has only two polarizations. That's a concept we know from electromagnetic waves, which have only two polarizations. And that is something you can measure if you take two polarized sunglasses, let's say. You try to send light through, they will only get through if they are rotated relative to each other in the right way. And in the same way, in general relativity, we know that the graviton only has two polarizations.
I see. So general relativity has a gauge symmetry, which predicts the number of polarization of gravitational waves. But this is only possible if you have a massless graviton. Let's say I want to have a massive graviton. What would happen to the gauge symmetry?
Well, the gauge symmetry of massive gravity would be different. And in fact, we'd have no gauge symmetry at all. And this would mean that the gravitational wave would have five polarizations.
But are there any problems with such a theory?
Yes. So the challenge is to make a model that only predicts five polarizations and not more. And the simplest model actually predicts six polarizations, the sixth one being a ghost, which has negative energy and it haunts the theory.
Then what do we do with this ghost? Is it over for massive gravity?
Well, there are actually a few proposed solutions. So one model was worked out by myself with two friends. It's called new massive gravity, and it's defined in 2+1 dimensions. That means you have two dimensions of space and one dimension of time. And another model is called DRGT model. This defined in the four dimensions of our universe and also solves the ghost problem. Now, it's not clear yet whether these models are fully viable models of our universe, because there are other consistency criteria like stability.
What exactly do you mean by stability?
So by stability, we mean that if we perturb a system, then it shouldn't change drastically. So consider it like a ball in a valley. If you give it a little kick, then it'll oscillate in that valley until the oscillations settle down and the ball is at rest again. So this would be a stable configuration. Now, if the ball were on top of a hill, and if you gave the ball a little kick again, then it would roll down the hill. And that would be an unstable configuration. And any model that we have for our universe must predict a stable one, because that's what we seem to observe. It's not like we have a universe that is drastically changing its properties every day.
That's right. So it's not clear yet whether we have a fully satisfactory model of massive gravity. And it could just be that maybe there isn't a fully viable model, and general relativity is the correct theory after all, and so the graviton would be massless.
Okay, so let's summarize a bit. If we had a small mass, we would still have to fit it with our observations. But from today's discussion, it seems that general relativity already does the job quite well. Though there are still ongoing tests, And it will be exciting to see if general relativity passes all of them, or if maybe a new theory is discovered in the process. For now, thank you, Olaf and Allison, for sharing with us this massive development.
Thanks for having us.
And thank you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.